Dear Chairlady, Evie, ladies and gentlemen, the acute abdomen ultrasound is the answer. And that's, of course, at the same time, the conclusion of my lecture. We need imaging because it isn't always as obvious as this image in which we can see the abdominal contents with the naked eye. What are the learning goals? To learn more about the most common and devastating pediatric abdominal emergencies, non-traumatic, to understand the value of ultrasonography in the acute abdomen, and to understand the consequences of any delay in diagnosis. So what's acute? Well, it depends on whose perspective you're looking at, because the child thinks everything is acute. The parents, of course, also, because they're also very anxious and concerned. But the worst person in this whole scenario is the pediatrician, because they think everything at any moment is a disaster and should be treated immediately. So let's look at this pathology from the perspective of the radiologist, who is the only, objective peacekeeper in this emotional jungle. So what about ultrasonography? We know it's not expensive. It's not cheap. It's not expensive. It's not painful. It doesn't involve any injections unless you give contrast, which I don't. So it's no radiation, and it's just fun. And it's an art. It's an art to make the images yourself. So first of all, it's age-dependent, and that's the outline of my lecture. I'll talk about newborns, infants and preschool children and adolescents. Let's start with the newborns, because we don't always need ultrasonography. For instance, in this child, three-week-old boy with abdominal pain, vomiting, and no passage of stools. Yes, he has an ileus, that is clear, but we can see the problem on the radiograph. It's an incarcerated inguinal herniation, so he can go to surgery immediately. We don't need ultrasonography for that. Or in this three-day-old boy who has vomiting and no passage of meconium yet. Yes, this is a distended abdomen. If we look at the radiograph, a lot of air, which is not beneficial for the ultrasound, of course, but we see a dilated colon, no air in the rectum, dorsally located fluid levels, which are obviously in the colon. So this is more or less diagnostic for Hirschsprung's disease. So we proceed immediately to an enema, confirming the diagnosis, and we don't need ultrasonography, CT, MR, or whatsoever in this case, because Hirschsprung's disease is functional bowel obstruction caused by aganglionic distal bowel. And when the diagnosis is missed, a fatal fulminant enterocolitis may occur and the child might die. So it is a serious disease, as this disease in which we perhaps don't need ultrasonography. In this seven-day-old boy, premature boy, who presents with rectal bleeding, distended abdomen, a discolored abdominal wall. And when we make the radiograph, it's immediate clear that we see intramural air, so this child has necrotizing enterocolitis, and we don't need any investigation for that. Etiology is ischemia, bacterial overgrowth, and if not treated, because it's really an emergency, sepsis and/or perforation will occur and may be fatal at this age. We can use ultrasonography, however, in these patients, for instance, to see the intramural, to see the intraportal gas, which sometimes is the first sign of necrotizing enterocolitis. You can see the small air bubbles in the portal vein. Ultrasonography is very sensitive for that. And we might find occult pneumoperitoneum between the liver and the bowel wall, small bubbles of air, which of course shouldn't be there. And if you squeeze, you can squeeze them away. So this is very minute amount of free intra-abdominal air, suggesting a perforation. That's also something about the sensitivity of ultrasonography. But otherwise, we don't need ultrasound, nor in this child, a one-day-old girl with bilious vomiting and an image like this. And remember, bilious vomiting is as green as grass. This is real bilious vomiting, not that yellowish stuff. It really should be green. That's a proximal obstruction looking like this. It's a complete obstruction, dilated jejunal loops. So obviously, this is jejunal atresia, and the child can go to surgery immediately. Don't wait too long with it, because these bowel loops can volvulate and they can have other problems. So immediate surgery is mandatory. Now we're going to the value of ultrasonography, because I don't understand this radiograph that much in this 7-day-old girl with bilious vomiting. And again, remember, bilious vomit is as green as grass. This is a serious sign. And actually, I don't know what's happening here. But performing ultrasonography, I know. First of all, is this a normal relationship between the superior mesenteric artery and the vein? No, it isn't, because it should be there. Now, this is not an emergency, but when we proceed the ultrasonography and go more in a caudal direction, then we see the real devastating problem for this child. The vessels are curling around each other, the whirlpool sign, which is virtually diagnostic for a volvulus. And that may be a devastating disease, because that may lead to complete necrosis of the small bowel, which is not compatible with life. So that's the value of ultrasonography, don't need CT. Or in this child, 3-day-old boy with a distended abdomen, no passage of meconium, and it looks like this, quite silly. It's not the radiograph of Hirschsprung's disease. What might this be? A little helpful might be this. There are no fluid levels, and on a close inspection, we can see something which we can call the soap bubble appearance, which might occur in meconium ileus. So that can be seen with ultrasonography. Why? Because in the small bowel loops, we see the tenacious meconium, which small bubbles of air trapped within the tenacious meconium. Or in more proximal loops, we can see the meconium sticking to the wall, causing some kind of pseudo-thickening of the wall. And these are all small bowel loops. Why? Because we can see the colon, and it's very small. It looks like the appendix, and this is a dilated, very proximal jejunal loop. So this more or less confirms the diagnosis meconium ileus, and then we can proceed not for diagnosis, but for therapy, try to evacuate the meconium by an enema with iodine contrast media. So, and when the diagnosis is missed, of course, we have the risk of perforation and volvulus of those very dilated bowel loops. So in the newborns, we have several acute situations which can severely damage the child. And some of those we don't need ultrasonography, and in other it can be helpful. And in some others, like midgut volvulus, it's mandatory. But anyhow, we don't need CT for these infants. Let's go to the infants and preschool children, toddler-like population. Let's go to this 3-month-old boy who has abdominal pain and abdominal distension for 1 week. Can be anything. But something is wrong. I think this is a dilatation of small bowel loops, or some passage problem. Ultrasonography immediately gives the diagnosis. So that's not that difficult. That's an intussusception. But it's always fun to analyze the intussusception. What kind of intussusception is? Can I reduce the intussusception? Because it looks a little bit silly to me. Within the intussusception, I see swollen, white mesenteric fat. So something is not okay in this intussusception. And it probably lasts for a week. So on close inspection, we see cloudy ascites. That shouldn't be there. It should be clear. So something has happened. Some fibrin threads within the ascites. And outside the bowel loop, we see small islands of hyperechoic fat. In my experience, that's inflammation outside the bowel loops. There's really something is going on, and it's probably necrosis. So the diagnosis was very simple. It's an intussusception, and of course you should treat it because it will proceed to ischemia, necrosis, and peritonitis. And in this patient, we didn't perform a reduction. Why? Because of the cloudy ascites, because of the inflammatory changes, because of the long duration, the young age, and also again the long duration, that's twice. So none of these things separately probably would prevent me from doing the reposition, but all these things together made the patient go to surgery, and they removed necrotic bowel loops and they made a resection of the ileocecal corner. So let's proceed to another patient, a 3-month-old boy, also 3 months of age, who has abdominal pain and an ileus, which you can see, for 1 week, following antibiotic treatment for some enteritis. And the stools were positive for Clostridium difficile. Really, something must be going on here. And I know if I put my transducer over here, I will see something, because there's no air, so there must be something else. So this is just a gift from heaven for me, at least during daytimes, not for the child, but for me. And then we see a very silly appearance of the colon. It looks like this. It has a thickened wall, but this is also wall. This is the lumen. You could see the air bubbles moving. This is vascularized, but this black layer isn't. And another remarkable fact, so we see a loss of stratification. We don't see the layers separately very good. There is an obvious wall thickening of the colon, but however, there's a preservation of the folds. Usually when the colon thickens, the folds will disappear. But in this disease, the folds will be preserved, and they will even look more intense than normally. And that is called the accordion sign. So the combination of the loss of stratification, the wall thickening with preservation of folds and the pseudomembranes, and this, which we call the accordion sign, makes this a pseudomembranous colitis, which can be made the diagnosis by ultrasonography, which is overgrowth of these bacteria, and the pseudomembranes, these, they consist of a coalescence of mucus, fibrin, epithelial cells, and exudate. And this can be a very severe kind of colitis. As this type of colitis, which looks different in this 2-year-old boy who has diarrhea and abdominal pain for 3 days. Can't be 3 years. And he also has anuria. And look at the sigmoid colon. There's a loss of stratification. There's a huge thickening of the wall, and to my surprise, there was no vascularization of that loop. And the descending colon, which was also thickened, had vascularization. So this is really peculiar. So we left now with a colon which has a loss of stratification. You don't see the gut signature anymore, or not as well as you hope to. There's wall thickening, in this case, with effacement of the folds. We don't see the folds anymore. And there's no visible vascularization. Then we only have a few possibilities, and knowing that this child had also anuria and hyperechoic renal cortex, as you can see over here, you can even see the cortex is swollen because the medulla is a little bit compressed. These are very small pyramids. So what's the diagnosis? Hemolytic uremic syndrome, which is a triad of E. coli-induced thrombotic microangiopathy, thrombocytopenia, acute renal failure. And this severe colitis may be a prodromal sign of this disease. So sometimes the radiologist is the first one to suggest this diagnosis. And treatment should be immediately, because this can result in long-standing renal failure. So this can be a disease which you may first come up with. So if we look at the serious diseases of infants and preschool children, we can diagnose intussusception, pseudomembranous colitis, hemolytic uremic syndrome, all very serious diseases, by ultrasonography. And we really don't need CT. So let's move to an older population, the children and adolescents, the school-going children and adolescents. Well, this is a simple case, at least an 8-year-old boy with pain in the right lower quadrant for 2 days and signs of focal peritonitis. Now, you don't need to be a radiologist to appreciate that this is appendicitis, a very severe one. But then it's fun to analyze what's happening to the appendix, because it's not only inflamed itself, also the surrounding is inflamed. You see a small covered perforation. You see a loss of architecture. So this is really a very diseased appendix with a lot of infection, of inflammation around it. Here again, we see the disorganization of the architecture, the covered perforation. And if we look at this diseased appendix, we see this spot. This is its own mesentery. And this is fatty tissue wrapped around the appendix. So you can recognize the basic anatomy by knowing the basic anatomy. Because as we know, the appendix looks a little bit like small bowel loops. And there's one major difference. The inner mucosal layer of the ileum, for instance, is folded. And in the appendix, it's always round. It's a single round layer. So again, what's the normal appendix? Inner hypoechoic band without folding. That's the one. Diameter should be less than 6 millimeters. It should be compressible. Sometimes we can see content, and sometimes if we take time enough, you can see even peristaltic movements within the appendix. Yes, it is a bowel loop, and then it's certainly normal. Normal mesenteric fat, and there is a moderate vascularity. If there's a little bit of fluid in the abdomen, which might be normal in children, you can see the normal mesentery of the appendix. And it's not as wide as it is when it's inflamed, and it's sharply defined. So let's go to the next patient, which really also is an emergency. This 8-year-old boy who has chemotherapy for a Burkitt lymphoma, and he has severe abdominal pain and diarrhea. And again, the abdominal film is not that helpful in making the diagnosis. It's helpful in diagnosing, well, something is wrong over here. We see, for instance, this is obviously bowel wall thickening. But this, again, is a present for the ultrasonographist because you know you will find something because there's no air. So something else must be there. Now, well, there is. Look at this. This is the cecum. It's huge. The valves, and this is the ascending colon. So again, we see wall thickening of the colon, this time with hyperemia, so obviously it's not hemolytic uremic syndrome. So we have loss of stratification, don't see any layers over there. There's wall thickening with some preservation of the folds, a little bit like this. There is hyperemia. And also the small bowel loops are involved. And although I don't have an image of this, you could see there was preservation of the folds of the ileum. There was a loss of stratification, as you can see. And that combination is quite typical in combination with a clinical picture of neutropenic enterocolitis, typhlitis, which is a potentially life-threatening inflammation of the cecum in children with profound neutropenia. And early recognition can be life-saving, which is quite easy with ultrasonography, as you can see. So some diseases in children and adolescents, and I haven't mentioned them all for the sake of time. I didn't mention ovarian torsion, hydrometrocolpos, inflammatory bowel disease. I did mention typhlitis and appendicitis. We can diagnose all the other diseases also perfectly well with ultrasonography, and we really don't need CT. So to conclude, pediatric abdominal emergencies are age dependent. In the majority of cases, the diagnosis can be made using conventional radiography, including contrast studies and ultrasonography. And in inconclusive cases, consider MRI over CT. I thank you for your attention.